My name is Dr. Rhonda Chervin, and I want to tell you about reasons for why the book of Dostoevsky, The Brothers Karamazov, is considered by so many to be the greatest novel ever written, and especially to deal with certain themes that are still important today that occur in the book. And I would like to pray that all you who hear this video or see this video and all you who read The Brothers Karamazov may be reached by this extremely dreadful yet inspiring story to repentance, conversion, and hope. Amen. The Brothers Karamazov was written by Fyodor Dostoevsky in the year 1880, and it's considered his masterpiece. A little bit of his life will help you to understand some of the themes. His father was murdered when he was a young man, and some of the scenes in the play reflect his own childhood, which was involved neglect. He tried out military life, and while he was in the military, he started writing stories, and people loved these stories. And then he got involved, when he came out of the military, he got involved in underground groups, which were sort of pre-communist groups of anarchists and rebels who were fighting against the social injustices that existed in society of that time under the auspices of the Tsar. And he was arrested for being part of this group, and he and some friends of his were supposed to be executed in the square. And the Tsar had sent a pardon, but said, don't pardon them till the last minute. So they had to stand there. They made their peace with God and the world and stood there expecting the bullet when a horse rode up and somebody got out and announced that they had been pardoned. But he spent 4 years in prison. And while he was in prison, he had a deep conversion experience. And this would be to Russian Orthodox faith, which is very similar to the Catholic faith, except insofar as they don't accept the authority of the Pope. But it's very sacramental and extremely filled with beautiful rituals, and it's a very venerable faith. And after his conversion and then exile, what they would do is, he had 4 years in the prison, and then he had to be in a town near the prison where he was kind of like the equivalent of what we would have when someone goes out but he has to report to someone, he's under scrutiny for a while. I forget what that's called, but in any case. And during that time, he fell in love with this woman who was a hysterical type of woman, extremely vibrant, emotional, and emotionally unbalanced. And this woman's character is reflected in the character both of Madame Hokolikoff and Katerina, that kind of personality. Anyhow, she died, and later on, when he was already working as a writer and was a very known, famous writer, what they did in those days is all the books that were going to come out were first serialized in the newspaper, and people would just hang on these episodes from his books, some of the most famous of which would be Notes from the Underground, Crime and Punishment, The Possessed, The Idiot. The Possessed is a book about a cell, like a pre-communist cell, and how demonic this gets, how the devil works on these characters and ultimately possesses them. And it was his critique of the whole leftist revolutionary movement is in the possessed. In the book The Idiot, he was interested in portraying what kind of man would be like a Christ figure or a saint for the 19th century and the coming 20th century. And he devised this character who's very lovable, but kind of a little too weak and naive, and he wasn't satisfied with that character. In the Brothers Karamazov, he attempts to depict what he thinks true holiness would be in the old elder Father Zosima, and then in the younger man, Alyosha, who was the disciple of the elder Zosima. And he was planning the first book. When you read the book, you'll see he keeps saying there's two novels. This is the first. The second novel was going to be after the Brothers Karamazov, following Alyosha as he becomes a sort of lay minister in the world. But he never got to write that book because he died before he could write that book. He married his secretary. People just started studying stenography in that time. And he hired this stenographer to take down his book. And he fell in love with this lovely young woman, and she with him. And they had children, and one of the children died when he was 3 years old. And that the feelings at the death of a young child are depicted later in the novel, The Brothers Karamazov. He died in 1881, and he was so beloved by the people that 30,000 people came to his funeral and followed a huge procession with his coffin through the streets. Even though he was a very faithful, strong Russian Orthodox believer, he struggled with doubt most of his life. And the way this doubt would occur to him, you see depicted in the brother Ivan Karamazov. And he himself would collect newspaper clippings about horrible, horrible things that were going on. Now, these horrible things, which when I read them as a child, as a teenager, when I first read this book, they seemed to me completely outlandish. I couldn't imagine anyone doing these things. These same things are happening right now in our culture. So, for instance, one of the most dramatic ones he talks about involves an article about parents who were so disgusted by their infant child wetting the bed that they would leave him in the outhouse all night long in the cold, and he would be crying and weeping, and they'd keep him there to punish him, and things like that. Well, we have these physical abuse and sexual abuse issues all the time in the news every day now. If you watch court TV, these kind of characters and, you know, this kind of cruelty and evil. He would collect these stories, and not he himself, Dostoevsky, but, well, it caused him doubt. He would think, how could a loving God allow this to happen? And then, of course, religious people would say, well, on earth there were all these crosses, but in heaven we will be happy. And he would say, the way he puts it, which is very typically Dostoevsky, and in the sense of he'd use very pungent, concrete images to get things across. So Ivan, when he's talking about these kind of awful stories, said, well, when I got to the pearly gates, when they hand me the ticket to get into heaven, I would turn the ticket back because I would say, a God who allows such terrible suffering on earth, I don't want to have anything to do with you. So this theme runs through the book. I'll hand the ticket back. So the doubter refuses to be consoled by some idea of heavenly bliss because the doubter cynically thinks kind of cynically or doubtingly thinks, a God who could allow such evils to happen can't be so good, so why do I want to trust and rely on him? And so this doubt runs through the whole book and is contrasted with the trusting childlike faith of Alyosha and the mature faith of Zosima, the elder in the monastery. Okay, so now themes that I would like to deal with in introducing you to the Brothers Karamazov and commenting on the Brothers Karamazov are four basic themes. And one of them is how the masculine and the feminine is depicted in the main characters of the book. Secondly, I want to deal with determinism and freedom, which was already an issue in those days. And determinism would be the theory that everything is caused by either psychology or sociological factors, society, and that you're just the victim of all these forces and you have no personal freedom and therefore no responsibility. A third one is how suffering purifies the heart, that even though we revolt against suffering, it purifies us and is designed to purify us. And then the fourth one is the issue of dreams of improving the world through either utopian ideals, such as the early pre-communists had, or socialists had, or theocracy, where the idea would be the church should take over and just make people be virtuous, you know, put that into law in such a way that the legal punishments for lack of virtue would force people to be virtuous, versus Dostoevsky's Christian solution, which is that the only thing that could make things better in terms of injustice is personal Christian love, heart to heart. That's what could make society better. So those are the four themes that I want to deal with. And let's go to the first one, theme A, which is about masculine and feminine. And we all have stereotypes of what typical men and women alike. And a lot of conversation goes on about, you know, is that really what men are like, or is that just a negative stereotype, or is that like women alike? I've written several books on this subject, one of which is called Feminine Free and Faithful. And in these books, I make a distinction between positive feminine traits, negative feminine traits, positive masculine traits, and negative masculine traits, because there's a positive stereotype and a negative stereotype that people deal with. And I believe that these generalizations are accurate, that most women, if they're good women, will have certain positive traits, and if they're very weak or bad women, will have these negative traits, and the same with men with positive and negative traits. And I see them exemplified in these characters. Dostoevsky didn't have a schema worked out philosophically about the feminine and the masculine. But if this is true, then anyone who's depicting life realistically is going to have characters that exemplify these traits. So thinking of the women in the book, you have Grushenka, who is this seductive, femme fatale woman who several of the characters are in love with. And you have Katerina, who's a upper middle class woman who has who Dmitri is in love with. And you have Madame Hohalikov, who's a widow who runs through the whole, her personality goes through the whole book, and her daughter Lisa, who is in love with Alyosha, the saintly one. And looking at these traits in this regard, I would see as positive feminine traits things like warmth, nurturing, sweetness, goodness, empathy, charm, responsiveness, intuitiveness, kindness, softness, purity. And then negative traits would involve such things as being weak, seductive, over-dependent, hysterical, manipulative, smothering, chatterbox, silly, catty, those kind of traits. And generally, with rare exceptions, Dostoevsky has male characters who are more saintly and some worse, but his feminine characters tend toward the negative feminine in many of their traits. And so this character Grushenka, there's incidentally a movie which is very poor, but still it's worth seeing anyway, just because it captures certain elements of the plot and atmosphere. So there's a movie that has Yul Brynner as Dmitri, and Grushenka is this woman who had a very difficult childhood, and she was befriended by a Polish man who seduced her, and she was in love with him, and he just rejected her, paid no attention to her, and eventually she became the assistant of an old man with whom she was also having a love affair, and she was his sort of helper, accountant, businesswoman type for him. And in the meantime, she was very seductive, very pretty, seductive, manipulative, and always trying to seduce men. So we have in the brothers Karamazov of the men, you have Father Karamazov, the father of these brothers. The father is this absolutely evil character, and I'll talk to you about more about him later under the negative masculine. But anyway, he falls madly in love with this Grushenka and wants to seduce her. And she plays these games with him all the time. So he offers her a huge pack of money. And she says, well, I want to see the money first. So he's waiting for her to come with this pack of money in his hand. And every night he leans out the window with this money, hoping she'll come and he can seduce her. And she keeps saying she's coming and then she doesn't come. And she torments him. So she would be an example of someone who's seductive, manipulative primarily. And Dmitri, the father Karamazov, Dmitri Karamazov is an army officer, and he's in love with another woman until he meets this Grushenka. And he falls madly in love with Grushenka and can't stand the idea that his evil father, who's a widower, is going to get this woman and seduce her. So he gets into this murderous rage and wants to kill his father rather than have his father get this woman who he's totally infatuated with. Now, in the meantime, Dmitri is engaged to a woman called Katerina. And this woman is a beautiful young woman, educated in Europe, with all sorts of fancy idealistic notions. And she's a little too good for the usual army officers. And she meets Dmitri, who's a real rough diamond, but very powerful, strong character. And she falls in love with him. And she has a hysterical streak in her. And what is this kind of feminine hysteria that Dostoevsky depicts beautifully, because his own first wife was like this. His second wife was a plain, simple, good person, good woman. without any of this. This hysterical tendencies would consist in making huge dramatic scenes out of any kind of frustration of vanity. And in those days, women who had hysterical scenes would faint easily. Now, the reason they'd faint was not because they were hysterical, but because they wore these awful corsets. And these corsets were so tight that they could hardly breathe to begin with. So if they got very excited and started panting, then that they couldn't breathe. So she reacts hysterically to all kinds of situations of frustration. So she reacts hysterically to Dmitri's behavior, but also to Grushenka's behavior, because Grushenka comes to know her. And Katerina imagines that because she's so much better, an upper-class woman compared to Grushenka, who's a lower-class flirt, that she, Katerina, is going to win Grushenka over. And there's this terrific scene where Katerina makes all these overtures to Grushenka to win her over. And Grushenka plays all these games, manipulative games with Katerina, and then sort of sticks her tongue out at her. And Katerina becomes absolutely hysterical over this. Katerina is also manipulative. She has all these different maneuvers she does to try to win Dmitri back, because she finds out that Dmitri is in love with this Grushenka, but she isn't, so she's jealous. Okay, this Madame Hakalikov is a young widow with a teenage girl, and she represents this kind of really weak, smothering, silly, chatterbox woman. She talks a blue streak, gossips about everyone, and is smothering of her daughter and everyone around her. Because she feels weak, she wants to try to control everyone. She can't, so she tries to manipulate them. And she's very silly and unrealistic. So these are all... Now, these women have certain positive feminine traits. So both Grushenka is charming and is actually has a warm part of her, which eventually comes out. She's actually empathetic and warm underneath all her seductive moves. Katerina is responsive, intuitive, sweet, nurturing. This Madame Kalikov is kind of charming in her own way. But this daughter, Lisa, her daughter, who is sick with some unknown psychosomatic illnesses, the daughter is hysterical as well as seductive. So these are the kind of women we're dealing with in the book. Now, what about the men? As positive masculine traits, I see strength, bravery, taking the lead, objectivity, being logical, daring, adventuresome, protective. And negative would be things like being brutal, domineering, lustful, rude, crude, arrogant, proud, overly ambitious, cold, and wild. And we see this in these characters. You have the father Karamazov is brutal, lustful. He has these orgies every night in his house. Now, he was married twice, and his first wife he was totally cruel to, and she dies. And his second wife was a saint, and he revered her, but at the same time he had all these loose women coming to his house for these orgies, these prostitutes and other kinds of loose women. So he was extremely lustful, crude, rude, proud, wild, and just a real brute. And then you have Ivan, who is the oldest brother, and Ivan is very is logical. He's a thinker type, a spectator thinker type. And he has a certain kind of strength. He has a certain type of strength to him, but not much. And he's also very proud. And this pride takes the form of contempt. He's contemptuous of everyone, either because he thinks they're stupid or because he thinks they're low and swinish, like his father. Now we have Dimitri, and he has many positive traits. He's strong, he's brave, he's daring, he's adventuresome, he's a leader type. But he also is extremely lustful, domineering, rude, somewhat brutal, and wild. See? And Alyosha is the saintly brother, and he is strong and brave and objective and logical and very protective. He's not adventuresome or daring or a leader particularly. And then you have a fourth brother who is the illegitimate child of the father and who has almost no positive traits. And this man is very arrogant, very proud, cold, extremely ambitious. And then you have Father, the great saint, Zosima the Elder. And he is strong, brave, a leader, objective, logical, protective. And he has none of those negative traits. So let's leave this now and go on to more on the next segment about this.